The phrase low carb usually really means low carb, high fat. It is nearly a consensus position in the low carb world that low carb, high protein is not sustainable. The objective in low carb, high fat diets is to attain an unusual metabolic state called ketosis, in which the body's carbohydrate stores, in the form of glycogen, are depleted. Consequently, acidic ketone bodies are created from stored fat, and they partially replace glucose as a fuel for your cells. Ketogenic diets, or diets that induce ketosis, have been used since the 1920s to control intractable epileptic seizures in children. It is from this therapeutic use that much of our understanding of these diets comes. High-fat diets have many of the same problems as high-protein diets. By limiting the consumption of healthy, plant-based foods, they limit the intake of important nutrients. While not saying so explicitly, low-carb promoters acknowledge the nutritional inadequacy of these diets because they demand the use of multivitamins and other supplements. As we review some of the primitive nutrition logic that underlies low-carb diets these days, remember that this aspect of the diet is quite necessarily modern. Our ancestors did not have bottles of pills and powders. Vitamin supplements are not a substitute for food. Whereas plant foods have well-recognized disease-fighting powers, the evidence for the benefits of vitamin supplements is a mixed bag. Some actually can be harmful. You won't find a well-designed study showing ill effects from eating whole plant foods, but vitamins have had a bad run recently. Multivitamins have recently been linked to breast cancer, for example. And here they were found to just be mostly a waste of money. Extracts of fruits and vegetables probably won't do you much good either. You have to actually eat these healthy foods, which would necessarily displace the low-carb foods in your diet. The fact is, you just can't create a nutritious diet from vitamin supplements, at least not yet. This is the conclusion I draw from the proven inadequacy of elemental diets. Elemental diets are purified, easily assimilated, supposedly complete nutrition formulas given to patients who cannot digest normal food. Despite their increasing sophistication, deficiencies still result from them. Generally, they are used as little as possible, and this is one reason why. Dietary antioxidants make important contributions to health. Beef USA will tell you that you should get them from food, not pills. They'll also tell you fruits and vegetables are the best food sources of antioxidants. Atkins himself knew that in his diet, you had no choice but to take supplements to have a chance of obtaining adequate nutrition. You might think this fact would be a problem for the Atkins people. Far from it. It creates an opportunity for them to sell supplements to the gullible people following their extreme diet. Why would someone consider such a deficient diet? It seems serious nutritional inadequacy is a pretty major flaw for a diet to have. The research must say there are some really great benefits to low-carb, high-fat to overcome this, right? I'll show you lots of research into low-carb soon and let you be the judge of that. Low-carbers imagine the body's metabolism is fragile and easily broken by even the healthiest high-carb foods. Somehow, we're to believe that only some people can tolerate starches, for example, even though all the world's population centers have historically eaten diets dominated by them. I have a hard time understanding how this type of reasoning makes it past the laugh test. Here are some high-carb Indians from around 1910. Do they look overweight to you? Here are some fakirs from around the same time. What about them? What do you think they ate? Now, maybe they appear undernourished to you, but the point is, carbs did not make them fat. I found these pictures randomly, but you can easily go on Google Books and find many more old photos of people from high-carb cultures. Good luck finding someone who looks fat. Poor people in pretty much every society used to eat primarily starch-based diets. Poverty has not been associated with obesity until recent times. Of course, diet is only one factor in explaining this, but I would think the idea that carbs make you fat would be hard to accept for any rational person with a sense of food history. On the other hand, low-carbers tell us that somehow liberal amounts of fats, meats, and oils can somehow promote weight loss. It's hard to figure, really. Who doesn't know that fats are the most calorie-dense macronutrient? It seems this fact creates some difficult math to overcome for low-carb promoters. I'll talk about this more in the next section, but for now, let's look at the research out there for low-carb diets. First, let's start with the basics. It is the consensus view of obesity researchers that the most important factor for weight loss is creating a calorie deficit. You need to use up more energy than you eat, simple as that. The particular diet you use doesn't matter much as long as you create that calorie deficit. If you need to lose weight, and you do so successfully, you will probably be at least a little bit better off regardless of your strategy. Here, for example, no advantage was found for a high-protein diet. No particular macronutrient balance was seen to have an advantage in this one, too. Have you ever noticed that people doing low-carb diets can't seem to stay with them very long? They seem to fall off the wagon a lot more than vegans do. This slide might give us an explanation for all that. To stay on a diet, you need willpower. But to have willpower, you need glucose. Low carb aims to keep your glucose low, so you probably won't have much of a chance of sticking with it very well. How ironic. Adequate levels of blood glucose will also keep you from craving fatty, unhealthy, high-calorie foods, too. If you are more likely to crave high-calorie foods, you will probably have a harder time achieving and maintaining your optimum weight. A dietary approach that endeavors to give you low blood sugar doesn't seem like a great strategy for having a healthy, long-term relationship with food. As I said, you would think there must be some really great research out there that makes low-carb look good. The most important factor you need to understand about the favorable low-carb studies is that all of them are short-term. Even a year or two-year-long study is too short to show all the harmful effects of a diet. The harm associated with high saturated fat consumption can take decades to build. A short study won't show that. But make no mistake, there is a lot of research that suggests these diets are harmful over the long term. If you're a low carber, as I go through these studies, I'd like you to ask yourself, if all this negative research were about vegan diets instead of high fat animal food diets, wouldn't it make you question the safety of vegan diets? High-fat diets are associated with brain aging and cognitive decline. This study saw heart impairments as well. There is also a lot of reason to worry about what these diets will do to your heart. I'll show you what I mean in part 2.